I am an internal medicine physician by training. I am also a captain in the United States Public Health Service. I went to the Uniformed Services Medical School and then did my internal medicine residency at the Mayo Clinic here in Scottsdale, Arizona. From there, I actually went directly to the Phoenix Indian Medical Center and have held a variety of positions there, including staff internist, acting chief of medicine, director of their research program, and then up until July of this past year, spent the past five years as acting director for their centers of excellence, which include their diabetes center of excellence. I was also acting clinical director and ambulatory care director there for the past year until transferring to the Phoenix area office in July of this past summer, where I currently am the deputy chief medical officer for the Phoenix area. So what we're going to talk about today is self-monitoring of blood glucose. We're going to go through a little bit of history about where it came from, how we started doing it, and where we are now. Talk a little bit about the use and accuracy of these machines, because knowing how accurate any device is or any test is imperative to your ability to apply it clinically. A little bit, talk about some of the evidence that's currently out there behind the use of self-monitoring of blood glucose and diabetes. Then we'll review the clinical guidelines that currently exist for the use of self-monitoring, and then we'll have some examples of practical approaches that folks can use every day in their clinical practice. The learning objectives at the end of the presentation, hopefully folks will be able to incorporate FDA-approved indications for using SMBG in managing patients with diabetes. They'll be able to summarize the information regarding the accuracy of the meters and glycemic control, be able to find and utilize the IHS standards of care for diabetes, and hopefully be able to take away some pearls that will allow you to change and incorporate something into your clinical or public health practice. So let's start with a definition. What is self-monitoring of blood glucose? So the Joslin organization, which is well known for their work in diabetes, defines self-monitoring of blood glucose as simply the checking of your blood glucose with a blood glucose meter. So, you know, Egyptians first made the mention of diabetes back around 1500. And during medieval times, there were many attempts to identify disease states by examining urine samples for appearance, color, sediment, and even taste. And in the 19th century, glucose was identified as being present in the urine. So Elliot Joslin, who founded the Joslin Diabetes Center, advocated in the late 1800s for the self-management concept that related diet and exercise and urine testing to keep urine sugar free. So the initial glucose testing was actually done in urine, and it actually required heat early on for the color development that they would see. And so this product, the Clinitest, was actually the first product to resolve the issue of the heat required by the development of a modified copper reagent tablet, which actually heated the urine mixture to a boil and was able to oxidize the glucose, changing the color that you see here, and so those were the first tests that were done. So then in 1957, they also realized that the urine testing, the Clinisticks, could also give approximate results from blood. And so something that was called the Dextrose Sticks was created in the 1960s. And this essentially was a paper reagent which used the glucose oxidase peroxidase reaction, but also allowed a large drop of blood to pass through to react with the dry reagents, causing the color change. And this was a semi-quantitative visual reading. So more interest in self-monitoring and in monitoring glucose continued, and then they developed reflectance meters. Reflectance meters allowed for some bedside testing, but they were very bulky and heavy and expensive. They went away from the reagent copper and the heating issues to enzyme electrodes, and they required less blood and battery operated, but still not too user friendly. So then we came to the first generation of the meters that we are getting to know or use today. These were qualitative results instead of quantitative results. They were able to considerably decrease user interface, user interference, and narrow the hematocrit ranges, but they still took a relatively long result time. And there was still enough operator-dependent steps where people really experienced a lot of errors. And we're talking result times in these first generators meters of 40 seconds to 2 minutes long. So they continued in their technological development, and we developed the second generation of meters, which basically required very small amounts of blood, shorter test times, they improved the accuracy, there was less interference, and those are the meters that we are continuing to use today, and you'll continue to see further development on.